My main objective in posting videos has been to share reviews and recommendations of lenses I've collected over the years. However, sometimes it's a good idea to step away and look at the real purpose of all this gear, and that is to take photographs. Photos that hopefully other people like and find interesting. So in this video, I'm going to consider what makes a great photograph. What are the factors that go into making a great photograph? And what does this tell us about how we can improve our own photos? I'm going to do this by setting out a fairly conventional formula of the main ingredients of a great photo, in a formula like this, and I'll describe how different parts of the photographic industry focus on different aspects of the formula. Then I'll explain why this conventional formula is missing an essential ingredient, and what this means for our own photographic endeavours. So let's get straight to the point, and start with the subject, the first factor that goes into making a great photo. We all have our favourite images, and we all have different views about great subjects. When I think of great photos, I think of the images from photojournalists or sports photographers I've seen in the media, or great portraits, or wonderful photos of places or nature, the kind of photos that appear in the National Geographic, for instance. There are a vast range of subjects we all like to take photos of, from the closest up macro shots all the way up to shots of distant galaxies. And some of the photos posted online of these subjects, from amateur as well as professional photographers, are stunning and truly great images. And I should also add at this point that great photographs can be in colour or in black and white. The next two factors that make up a great photograph are the photographer and the photographic gear he or she uses. I'll begin with photographic gear. Today we have various ways of taking photos using film or digital technology, and I've listed some of the alternatives on the screen. Each type of camera is perfectly capable of taking great photos. It's definitely not the case that only the most expensive photographic gear takes the greatest photos. Yes, it's true that some of the greatest photographers in history have used the best equipment, but it's not always the case. Not all the greatest photographs have been taken with the best, most expensive gear. Which brings us on to the third ingredient to making a great photograph, the photographer. One of the skills of taking a great photograph is being in the right place at the right time with the right subject and being able to capture that moment in time. Actually, this is more a mix of skill and luck, as luck can play a big part in taking a great photo. But being in the right place at the right time with the right subject is not the only factor. You also need to capture that moment without screwing up the image. You need to get the composition right with the right areas in focus and the right exposure settings, or at least produce a good enough result to be able to process the image later. Even with the most automated devices, such as point-and-shoot cameras and mobile phones, you still need to get the shot right. For example, it's great to have mobile phone cameras at hand to capture impromptu scenes without having to worry about the settings. But sometimes when you look at the results, you find you've messed up the composition. There's a finger in the frame, or the phone is shaking so much the image comes out all blurred. Even highly automated cameras need some skill to use. The fourth factor in making a great photo is the processing. How the photo is processed once it's taken, including cropping, cloning, adjusting the contrast or colours, or sharpening all or part of the image. And this may not just be processing by the photographer, because sometimes the photo editors of newspapers or magazines process photos as well, by cropping an image, or even cloning out distracting or unwanted parts to improve the composition. And they can turn a good photo into a great image. There are plenty of examples of how great photographs have been processed. The way some famous old Soviet images have been changed for propaganda reasons is particularly interesting. This brings us on to the fifth element of what makes a great photograph, and that's how the photograph is presented and shared with others. In the old days, the only way to present a photograph was by printing it off or having it printed in a newspaper or journal. Today, we can all simply share photographs electronically via the internet. And this has dramatically changed the way we look at and share photographs and the numbers of views photographs receive. Online channels have introduced us all to some truly great photos taken by professional and amateur photographers, all part of the importance of how photos are presented. So this is a conventional formula for what makes a great photograph. And it could be argued that if you ace all the elements of this formula, then you've got the potential to produce a great photo. One thing you'll notice is that different groups in the world of photography tend to place a different emphasis on different parts of the formula and give more importance to some parts than others. Producers of cameras and lenses naturally push the importance of photographic gear, and independent reviewers also focus on gear. After all, it's their job to review the gear. If you draw a pie chart showing the relative importance of different factors, then for producers and reviewers, camera gear is the most dominant factor, followed by the photographer, especially in the way a photographer interacts with the gear, how nice it's to hold and use, how good the sensor is, how the lens renders great images, and so on. By the way, this pie chart is not based on a factual survey, it's just for illustrative purposes, so please add any comments you have on how I've ranked these and other areas. One thing I know bugs people is the lack of proper emphasis on post-processing in the reviews, except to play around with dynamic ranges and darker parts of an image, or comment on RAW versus JPEG engines. When you look at photos presented by producers and reviewers, it is relevant to ask just how much processing needs to be done to images to make them look great. Quite a lot sometimes, one suspects, certainly more than shown on this chart. This is how camera and lens companies and reviewers tend to see great photos being made. However, for the photographer, or a viewer of great photos, there can be other more important factors and a host of other permutations for what makes a great photo. For many people, it's the subject matter that catches the eye and how the photograph is presented. These factors are much more important than the photographic gear used by the photographer. People don't generally look at a great image and say, "Oh yes, that was taken with a Canon or Nikon or Leica. That's why it's a great image." Only after admiring a photo, they might try and find out who took it and what gear they were using. But then, if like me, you enjoy collecting and using vintage lenses, for example, then the pie chart would change again. The camera gear again becomes a critical element in producing images, images that some people feel have a more unique character than modern gear can produce. And the photographer is critical because taking photographs is a more manual and involved process. Old lenses also place more emphasis on post-processing because the images can sometimes lack contrast and pop straight out of the camera, something that software can remedy. I don't know about you, but I've often bought an old lens chiefly because I've seen a great photo or a set of great photos taken by the lens with a look that I'd like to own and try. And it's only then that I search for subjects that will help show off that character. A great photograph, then, in this conventional theory, is made up of a mix of the subject and the four P's. Not every single ingredient of a great photograph needs to be great in itself. You can have a great photo that captures a great moment in time, but it was not necessarily taken with the best camera gear or by a great photographer. So far, so good. However, if you really test the formula to destruction, you'll find there's something missing, an important aspect of a great photograph that it can't explain. For example, if you have a great subject and a great photographer with great gear and all the rest, does this guarantee you'll get a great photo? I don't think it does. Yes, it guarantees you'll get a technically good photo. But others might look at it and think, it's a good photo, but it doesn't do much for me, it's not that great. In today's photography world, you can see numerous images online of amazing subjects and scenes, images that are wonderfully well taken and processed and presented in the highest of high definition. But not all of these images make a big and lasting impact on the viewer. We've all seen photos where we've admired their technical qualities, but there's also something special missing, something that fails to really hold our attention and interest. Sometimes I think you could call this yet another bloody good, but actually I've sort of seen all this before sunset snap syndrome. And there's a second flaw in the formula. Because if all the elements of taking and sharing a photograph are poor, does this mean you'll never get a great image? Again, I don't think it does. There are great photos that are a result of extremely poor technical factors and rather dodgy subjects, but despite these problems, they've made a huge impact on others. And it's that impact on others that I believe is missing from the formula. Because unless a photograph has a strong impact on others, then it's not really a great photograph. Anyone who claims to have taken a great photo, well, in reality, they're not the right people to judge the result. It's other people, the people looking at the photograph themselves, who are the judges. This is an important lesson for us all. It's that when we take a photograph of a particular subject, and we decide to share that photo with others, it also helps to consider what kind of impact it will have on others. And in particular, consider what we can do to increase its impact. It may be something about the composition, or the lighting, or the way the image is processed or cropped. It's a bit like what the expert judges on painting and photography competitions tell the contestants. Show us what you're seeing through your eyes or your lens, but also show us something that is different, something that is unique, something we haven't seen before, something that will grab our attention. There's also the strong impact when a photograph helps to tell a story, a feature that is at the core of the best photojournalism and sports images. Some of the greatest photos in history really do tell a powerful and fascinating story. And that's an important lesson for us all, even when we're thinking of a title for posting a photo. And the importance of impact and storytelling is something we can also learn from the ever-increasing use of mobile phone cameras, together with instantly sharing images on other people's phones. Because I reckon that people taking and sharing photos on mobile phones do tend to think a little more about the impact of those photos than others. And part of that impact is telling a story of what is going on in their lives or other people's lives. If they're going to share photos, then they will, consciously or subconsciously, consider the impact those photos will have on others. And if they don't, they may find out the hard way that they should have thought more about it. It's not just about the positive impact their shared photos have on others, but also the potential negative impact. For example, will other people enjoy seeing this image? Is it worth sharing? Will others enjoy seeing where I am now and who I'm with? If it's a selfie, what will they think about how I look? Or alternatively, how could sharing a particular image hurt other people? So in conclusion, I'd argue that it's the impact on others, as well as the more technical aspects of taking and sharing photographs, that goes into making a great photo. I hope this discussion has had some impact on you as well. I'd be interested to hear what you think about it, and important points I may have missed, so please add your views in the comments below. I'll be posting some more lens reviews soon, so please subscribe if you haven't already, and thanks for watching.